people look at you today, 20 years later, and they still have no idea what you're about. Tell me in a sentence who you are.
Nobody. I'm nobody. I'm a tramp, a bum, a hobo. I'm a boxcar and a jug of wine. And a straight razor if you get too close to me.
Whatever it is you're a part of.
Everything's a reflection of this. When you reflect that, you reflect music. I reflect it in music. That's me.
Today, Mr. Manson, the panel from the Board of Prison Terms that you see before you will once again consider your suitability for parole.
I'm an outlaw. They're right there, you know, and I'm a gangster, and I'm bad, and I'm all the things that I want to be. I'm pretty free within myself. I cut people, and I shoot them, and I do whatever I have to do to survive in the world I live in. I have to deal with every kind of psychotic maniac you got in the world trying to burn me up, trying to beat me up, trying to get some attention to get me in any kind of direction they can. I really wasn't up on the 60s as much as you all make me out to be. I had just got out of prison. People came around me because I played a lot of music and I was fairly free and open because I really didn't know, honestly. Everyone says that I was the leader of those people, but I was actually a follower of the children because, like, I never grew up. I've been in jail most of this time, so I stayed in the minds of the children. I am nobody. I'm nothing. I'm now. I've been now all my life. My mother went to prison and left me. And everybody's lied to me. So all I did was I was honest with a bunch of kids, and they would come to me and say, we ain't got no place to stay. And I said, well, I ain't got no place to stay either. And they say, well, can we stay with you? I said, can you stay with me? They say, well, we want to be a family. I say, don't put no tags on my toes, man. Don't give them people nothing to identify with that they can come back and put me back in the penitentiary with. I'm bad. I'm as bad as I gotta be when it comes down. I deal. And I can deal from the bottom just as easy as I can deal from the top. And I cheat if it comes to where I need to cheat. And I steal if I need to steal. If I'm too hungry and I can't feel it any other way, I'll do whatever I can do to survive. Just like I've always done.
Do you feel any responsibility for the murders?
Sure.
Okay. Could you elaborate briefly?
I influenced a lot of people, unbeknownst to my own understanding of it. I didn't understand the fears of people outside. I didn't understand the insecurities of people outside. I didn't understand people outside. And a lot of things that I said and did affected a lot of people in a lot of different directions. It wasn't intentional. And it definitely wasn't with malice or forethought.
Mr. Manson, did you go to the residence after the murders?
No. Let me explain that to the board. The reason they want to say that is because they should have let me out of here 3 years ago, because if I'm not on any scene of the crime, you can only keep me 18 years and you've already had me 23, so I could sue you for Hearst Castle probably.
Okay.
They told you all these trips about what I said and when I said it. How in the hell could you possibly know what I said to somebody 25 years ago in the corner of when we were only talking to ourselves, and I couldn't even remember what I said. I may have said just anything, but I know what I would say now, and I don't lie, so I know what I would say then. You know, and I certainly wouldn't tell nobody to go in and do nothing to anybody that I wouldn't want done to me.
What has Mr. Manson learned in the almost 23 years that he has been in prison for these murders? In my estimation, Mr. Manson has learned nothing. He has no respect for authority. He has no respect for society or desire to be part of it, and he has no remorse for directing the murder of any of these 9 victims. I would respectfully ask the board to find Mr. Manson unsuitable for parole and to give him the maximum 5-year denial.
If you want to give me a parole, I might consider taking that and letting you live in my world. If you deny my parole, you go off in your world. Don't come back in mine. If I'm not paroled,
okay,
and I don't get a chance to get back up on top of this dream, you're gonna lose all your money. Your farms ain't gonna produce.
You're gonna win. Helter Skelter. You're gonna win your reality. You're gonna get everything that you want right from the pages of that court. That's gonna be your reality, and you're coming. You're growing up, and you're gonna be there just like you want him to be there. That's where he's coming, because that's what you're making for yourself.
All right, we're gonna recess for deliberation. We'll call you back after we make a decision. The panel reviewed all the information received and relied upon the following circumstances in concluding that the prisoner is not suitable for parole and would pose an unreasonable risk of danger to society if released at this time.
Yeah, they offered me a place in Valachi.
Who was they?
The FBI.
What do you got to do with the FBI? You don't have nothing to do with the FBI.
Yes, I do. I was a barber in the federal penitentiary for 20 years.
You're a snitch?
No. That's the reason I didn't take the program. They've come to me two or three times. They want me to work and do different draw profiles. I'm not really an informant type guy. You say in your minds that I'm guilty of everything that you've got on paper. So therefore, it would run logic that I would need to have remorse for what you think is reality. They built whole penitentiaries in the fear that they generated off of this case so the public can feel safe against this monster, and it's okay if I have to spend my life in prison. You've medicated me, you've burnt me, you've beat me, you've stabbed me, you've done everything you can do to me, and I'm still here, and you're still gonna have to face the truth about this case sooner or later, if not here in the street.
Are you so afraid of that, that's got your mind locked up?
No, I don't understand.
Go over to the morgue and look at all them dead people.
Just explain to me, though. I'm not dumb. Explain to me simply why that house that night, why they
went
there.
Which house? Which night?
The house on Cello Drive, the Tate house. Why did they go there that night?
Because Tex had been there before, and he went to a familiar place.
And why did they kill people that night? What did they think they were doing for you?
They freaked out, man. Tex was stoned. Everybody was loaded, man.
He said he wasn't. He said he was coming off an LSD trip. He had a little speed.
Well, not around me. He didn't have no speed because I wouldn't allow no speed on that ranch. I kick ass over there.
I don't allow that stuff around me.
I take a little grass, a little LSD, but none of that was destructive. Anyway, you can ask any of them other girls that'll tell you that. The other side of this game, I don't play drugs. I play light, dibby dabby chippying, but I don't really get down heavy with it.
What did they think they
were? Are we ready here, man?
Yeah, we're ready.
Are we ready here?
Ready.
Okay, ready. War.
What did they
war.
Think they were
doing? We are at war now.
But what did they think they were doing for you?
They wasn't doing anything for me.
What did they think they were doing for you?
Okay. If you are me and I am you, everything you do is for you, it's for me too.
So what did they think?
Oh, if you're in one mind, if I am you and you are me and we are all together, and then who's responsible for a calm together over me right now? Ba-da-da-da-da. It's all his fault. Oh, no, it's his fault. No, we put another false face on it. It's Halloween. It's your fault. So now, wait a minute. Criminal behavior is the same. It's mundane in most minds. Criminal always go to a familiar place. Tex had been to that house. Tex went back to that house. Here's the conversation. Indian Mesa. We got four campfires. We got four queens on a motorcycle gang, a motorcycle group that rides SS motorcycles out of Venice, Santa Monica. So we're riding motorcycles and we're all up there and we got these fires going and we got this big problem that came up. I had to go shoot somebody for Tex. Bobby's in the prison. My brother's in jail. Now, understand my mind, all my life I've been in jail because I didn't have no one to get me out of jail. I didn't have no brother outside. So I spent years and years and years and years just because nobody would come sign their name and get me out of jail. And the jail couldn't let me out because I didn't have no place to go. So I spent 22 years in prison because I didn't have nobody outside. I can't let somebody that's with me stay in jail. It just ain't, it's not in my makeup, man. I got to get my brother out of jail.
So you needed money to do that.
Well, here's the division between your mind and my mind. Here's where the chamber opens up. When you get in trouble, you go to your mother. You call up mother. I ain't got no mother to call. Well, you go to the bank, draw some money, pay a lawyer. I ain't got no money. I can't go to no lawyer. I go to a lawyer, I ain't got enough money. I got a little money. And anytime anybody knows anything about lawyers, when you got a little money, they're just taking that. They'll take the little money and let you sue them in court. You dig? In other words, like, I don't have enough money to go to the lawyer to get Bobby out. So everybody stand around and I said, pay me. Pay me what you owe me. Now, And he said, well, how do we do that? I said, get my brother out of jail. He said, how do we do it? I said, I don't know how you do it. I don't care how you do it. Do it. Now. Do it. And he said, how do we do it? I said, don't ask me how to do it. I don't want to be no part of no conspiracy. But however you do it and get it done now. And they said, well, we don't know what to do. We'll get a lawyer. And then, here, Leslie and Patty, they said, if we get a lawyer, all they're going to do is lie and take our money anyway. Now, system, blame it on your lawyers. If your lawyers ain't lying and taking the money of the poor people, then the poor people got a court to stand on, and they got rights as individuals for a revolution they fought in 1776 that guarantees rights to a common, ordinary farmer, poor man on the street like me, a rebel. I got my rights in the 76 courtroom. If you don't give me my rights in the courtroom, then I become King George. And I got all the rights then. And when I stand on the mountain and I say, do it, it gets done. If it don't get done, then I'll move on it. And that's the last thing in the world you want me to do, because I got that Confederate sword in the kitchen. Don't invoke me. Do it. Get it done. How do we do it? I don't know. I don't want to be involved in it. I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. In Japan, they call it ninja. I don't get involved in violence. I'm not a violent human being.
Did you tell the women to do their witchy things?
I said, if you're going to do something, leave something witchy. Just like I would tell you, if you're going to do something, do it well. And leave something witchy. Leave a sign to let the world know that you were there. Have a good day.
Did you tell them which words?
No.
Pig?
No.
Helter skelter?
No. Nope.
Arise?
Nope. It's not my vocabulary. That's not my generation. I keep telling you that. My generation.
Leslie said, in the car on the way to the La Bianca house, mm-hmm. You said, this time, make sure they're not scared like last night.
Oh, no. It may have been something like this. I remember something like that, but I don't remember exactly the right words. I don't remember exactly the right words, but that's a simple philosophy from China. That's a Chinese philosophy, you know. If you're gonna go to war and you're fighting your enemy, and you kill him when he's afraid, you know, it's a bad omen. It's bad. It's bad. So you try to absorb the fear. I think the Hindus use that word, karma. To balance of karma.
And that's why you reassured Mr. LaBianca?
No, I mentioned that in a conversation about something. Mm. You know, what it was about, I don't know. You know, but I remember the conversation. Look. Listen. My words. I live and die by my words. I've lived and died by my words all my life. For 45 years in prison. I keep my word. My word is my bond. I walk on my word. I live on my word.
Do you want the world to let you alone and turn away?
Listen. I broke no law. Try to understand that. I broke no law. I didn't step out of line with God, and I didn't step out of line with the man. I did not break the law. Now, I told those people the same thing that the United States president would tell them. The only way that you can dispensate life and death is you have to be willing to give yourself to that cause. You can't fight a revolution. You can't do anything unless you're willing to submit yourself to that cause. Take right, left, face. In other words, that's what you learn in the military.
Did you tell them to mutilate so that it would be memorable, so that people would know something was going on?
Batterana.
Did you tell them to do it in a memorable way?
I told you what I told them. If you're going to move and you're going to do something, do it with your soul and your heart. Do it right, man. Don't half-step on it.
Did they do it right?
I don't know. That's up to them. They live with that. They're responsible for their actions. I'm responsible for my actions.
You think the world's going to forget about you?
Which world? Every person in here is a world.
This united world of America. You think it's going to forget about you now and
forget,
move on?
Forget, forgot. forget, forgot. That's better. Vital, vital, vital. Ping, boom. We're trying to unify Germany now. Look here. See, here's another thing you guys don't understand. You've got an underworld and an overworld. You guys live in the overworld. I live in the underworld, you know. It's like you think the Second World War is over. Second World War is not over. You understand what I'm telling you? The Second World War is not over.
Is Charlie Manson crazy?
Whatever that means. Sure, he's crazy, he's mad as a hatter. What difference does it make? You know, a long time ago, being crazy meant something. Nowadays, everybody's crazy. So, I mean, you know, like, you know, synonymous. I mean, it's an irony, man. It's a paradox. I mean, are you crazy? Dressed in black? You think I don't know everything that goes with that black you're dressed in? Yeah. Where's your black gloves? You got your rings. You think I don't understand your blue rings and your yellow biscuit? Blah, 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 blah. You think you're anything wrong? Yeah, and then behind that, then, you know, there's a... So...
What do you think about all day long?
I don't. I try not to think. I try to clear my mind.
Are you a changed man? They say they're changed women.
Changed. I was a changed man when I got out last time. I learned. I learned my lesson well.
What's the lesson you've learned from all this?
I don't exist in your world. I'm only what is. What it is! It is what it is. Tension.
Do you think they were uniquely children of those times, or you think kids would do the same thing?
I think
thing
those
again?
Kids were beautiful.
And do you think kids today would do the same thing
if I say that, you're going to put me in another conspiracy? And now everything that derives from this is going to be all my fault. I'm coming back because, you know, Orlando, it's you. You know, like, where does the buck stop? Does it, you know, like...
Do you want to come back?
Come back where?
With more followers.
Oh,
more,
come on, more followers. More. Ain't it just a bun of boom, boom, baby bucks on Brandon?
You said you were the heart of the place.
I had no followers.
You said you were the energy of the place.
I was the energy of the place only because I was there. I didn't even realize I was the energy of the place. You know, I didn't know everybody out there was dead. I really didn't. You know, I really honestly didn't know that everybody was running on what someone else said. You know, they said the kids come up and they said, "What can we do?" I said, "Do whatever you want to do." And they said, "You can't tell the children to do whatever they want to do."
How did you learn what they'd done?
But over the period of years, I've figured it all out. I went through my mind to figure out how things happen, you know.
But how did you learn what had happened those two nights, the next day and then the day?
Oh, no, it took years, man. I've been going through a lot of changes in here. I was on cell 13 in death row, walking back and forth, saying, how did I end up here? I was headed for, I was going to San Diego. What did I do here? You know, in other words, like, wow, this is not, I didn't pick this trip. I didn't ask for this hand. That's what I said. We'll hold you on a table and we'll deal this hand to you. Hey, you got a hippie cult leader? I'm not a hippie cult leader. I never was a hippie. I don't know what a hippie was,
but
man.
But I come back one more time. I want to ask this one more time. You were not a shocked man when they came back.
All right, I'll put it to you this way. Would you do me a favor when you leave? Talk to this lieutenant and ask him if he's shocked by what goes on in here every day. I see blood in here every day. Every day someone's getting shot, someone's getting cut, someone's getting beat. I've lived in that all my life, woman. That don't wrinkle up my forehead. You can pile up 100 dead bodies up in front of my cell and it don't set me to do nothing. You know, my mind is not set like that. I don't, I don't work like that.
You weren't surprised.
Let me say this. I feel bad. If anybody feels bad, I don't like to see any negative happen to anyone. I don't like to see children die. I don't like to see automobile accidents. I don't like to see people hurting each other. I don't like none of that. I don't get a thrill out of that, you dig? But I'm not going to sit here and tell you a bunch of malarkey. I'm not going to fill you up with bunk. If I can't fill you up with right, I'm not going to fill you up with nothing. So I'm filling you up with this. I tell you, and I tell you right up into the highest peak of your understanding, I did not break the law. It's that simple. I did not break the law. Now, all my life you told me, system, society, ignorance of the law is no excuse. Now, if you don't know the law, that's sad.
But why don't you take a... When you think about that woman and her 8.5-month-old baby.
Oh, my goodness. Here we go. Let's bleed hearts. Let's bleed. Why don't we just cut ourselves and just die because we feel so bad? We don't feel bad. What about them other people? What about them poor people starving to death over in the Appalachians? Do you think about that? What about the boat people that and all the other people that died over there? Well, what about that little girl that ran through My Ling and all them people you shot and killed over there? Did you feel bad about that? Did you feel bad about the Second World War when you piled bodies up to the sky? Come on, man. Don't even put all that feel bad on me. You're the one that's feeling bad about it. If you're feeling bad about it, why don't you write a book or something and make some money?
So what's the word for these two women today?
What's the word?
What do you want to ask them? What's your word to them?
How much time we got?
Time enough for you to say.
Okay, let me go to the restroom.
Do we have time for him to? No, you got to answer and then go, because this is it.
Well, if there isn't anything that can't be explained in time, if we had the time to explain it.
Just give me a question for them. They got to pose something to you. What do you want to pose to them?
Okay. If, and that's a big word, because I don't hardly ever use those words like if and maybe. I'm not insecure about anything. But if you have a thought in your mind about what I'm thinking, is that what I'm thinking, or is that what you're thinking I'm thinking? Everyone says, we know what you were doing with all those women. I said, no, you know what you would have been doing with all those women, and you think that's what I would be doing with all those women, because that's what you need to think. Now, you've spent all this time over there in that women's prison listening to all the particulars of what women do in and out of criminology and crime, judges in robes. Have I ever lied to you about anything? Have I ever lied about anyone to anybody about anything? Is there any time in all the time you've known me, have I ever told you anything that wasn't right or true?
What's the first word that comes to mind when you think of those two women?
Leslie don't know me. Leslie was only at that ranch a couple minutes.
But today?
Patty, I'm surprised. Patty has picked up a lot of suffering. Now, here's the thing. You stand for a cause, and that cause begins to crumble. And you crumble with the cause because you don't have to hold on. You don't have nothing to hold on. You fall up underneath everybody else's opinion. And you're turned around by what they think, because you're looking back off in society, and she's not been in jail long enough to know that society that she's thinking about is not the society that's really going on. The society 25 years ago that she has in her mind is gone. That society moved on. There's another back window on this trip.
You did. So the word for them?
Word?
Yeah, what are they? Give me a word.
You are your faith. Lose it, and you're not.
We are done.
Is that right or wrong?
True.
Yeah. If they lost faith in what they did, that's on them. I didn't lose faith. Have a good day.
Hold on, don't stand up. I just wired this mic here.
Think of all the questions I expected you to ask them. Can I go to the bathroom? Is not the one that would have come to mind.
Hey, look here, man. Hey, are you going to send me a copy of that?
Sure.
The still pictures.
Yeah.
Still pictures.
I've been trying to get a still one for a long time, man.
I don't know. We got to ask the prison, but we'll ask them.
You don't have to ask the mail room. They do things like that.
Excuse me. Hold on.
Charlie, they probably want to get their picture taken with
them. Let me look serious.
Are you going to look serious?
Denise, you can get it.
Yeah.
Are you taking one for publicity?
I'm trying to, yeah. I mean, hopefully one of these will work. Get one with Diane.
Let me get out of there.
So we should do one. Let's see. Like so.
That's fine. If you're so close,
you probably need to store that.
Never
over here.
You from Kentucky, huh? Mm-hmm. What part?
I was born in the South, near Tennessee, and grew up in Louisville.
Here we go. One, two, three.
My uncle, Wormy, died in Louisville, Nutwood.
Just take a couple.
You know, mm-hmm. Trying to save the atmosphere when the Tennessee Valley Authority came in.
Mm-hmm.
We started CC camps back then. My grandfather started CC camps before the Second World War. And then when the Second World War came along, they forgot the CC camps. Mm-hmm. Now when you introduced Red, mm-hmm. when you talked to Red,
mm-hmm.
Red started the CC camp back.
Mm.
I'm telling you, those children did right. It's just sad that there wasn't more of them. The world's coming to an end.
You were born in Ohio, right?
Your atmosphere is dying. My mother ran off from Ashland, Kentucky, mm. and went to Ohio.
Oh, sorry,
did
I put my hand in the baby?
That's okay.
You know, everybody likes this
everybody
evil.
Wants a picture of you.
Everybody likes that evil character they created. You know, that guy with the eyes.
Who's got mine?
You got to realize, man, all the guys you've been creating are not really real in real life, man. All right.
Hold on, just one second.
Don't forget me on those pictures, gentlemen.
Just one. Just one. Just one. Little one.
You want him standing or sitting?
That's fine. Thanks.
And let me give you all something, another thing. Will you please?
Yeah.
Everybody says I'm 5'2". When I was arrested, I was 5'7". Then I went down to 5'6". Then I went down to 5', then I went to 4'. Now I'm down to 5'2". Pretty soon I'll be 5'. By the time that you all die, I'll be about 3 feet tall.
So how tall are you, Charlie?
5'6".
Okay.
And 3/4".
Charlie, you were real nice. Thank you.
Charles Manson is serving his life sentence for murder in San Quentin Prison. That is where we talked with him and with Newell Emmons, author of Charles Manson, in his own words. Our conversation lasted an hour and a half, during which Manson was sometimes lucid, sometimes incoherent, and frequently manipulative.
From your words, as Mr. Emmons quotes them in this book, it's clear that you were guilty of murder, and yet he says in all his conversations with you, he never heard you express remorse. Have you never felt it?
Remorse for what? You people have done everything in the world to me. Doesn't that give me equal right? I can do anything I want to you people at any time I want to, because that's what you've done to me. If you spit in my face and smack me in the mouth and throw me in solitary confinement for nothing, what do you think's going to happen when I get out of here? Guilty. I wouldn't do anything that I felt guilty about.
You don't feel guilty at all?
There's no need to feel guilty. I haven't done anything I'm ashamed of. Maybe I haven't done enough. I might be ashamed of that, for not doing enough, for not giving enough, for not being more perceptive, for not being aware enough, for not understanding, for being stupid. Maybe I should have killed 400 or 500 people, then I would have felt better. Then when I felt like I really offered society something. You know, if I wanted to kill somebody, I'd take this book and beat you to death with it, and I wouldn't feel a thing. It'd be just like walking to the drugstore.
Do you feel blame? Are you mad? Do you feel like wolves kebabs right frantic? Get frantic, booch, 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 booch.
Newell Emmons is an ex-convict who first met Manson in prison in the 50s. He claims he wrote the Manson book after 7 years of conversation with Manson to show that he's no leader, no guru, but just a loser.
Why should anyone care to read this book?
My purpose when I first started was virtually to destroy the myth. I show that he's not as complex or as the occult leader or et cetera that he's been projected as being.
I don't fit in society and I am incompetent. I'm definitely incompetent.
No, that's not what I said.
Well, I say that. I say that. No, there's nothing wrong with being incompetent because you don't have to do as much. if you're competent, then you got a lot to do, see? But there's another aspect of it too. I've learned to reflect. I just reflect back. I know I don't know. I know I'm stupid. I admit I'm a petty whatever. I've never been a success at anything. I even got to the point where I didn't want to be a success at anything. What would being a success, what does that mean, you know? Money?
Oh, I've had all the money in the world three times and I had to give it back. That's a stupid little game, you know? My awareness and my consciousness is not the same as somebody that goes to school and has a mom and dad. See, not having parents have left me in another dimension, so to say, you know? I don't have no bad going for nothing. I don't judge. I hardly even think about too much. It's hard for me to remember breakfast. In fact, if I didn't have two or three girls to help me, I would pretty much be lost and I wouldn't know what the hell I'm doing.
You write in that in all your conversations with Charles Manson, he never expressed remorse.
Have you seen any today? I mean, perhaps he believes totally in his own mind that he's not guilty.
You guys got this stuck in your head that I've murdered somebody. You've got it stuck in your brain that I murdered somebody. What do you want to call me a murderer for? I've never killed anyone. I don't need to kill anyone. I think it. I have it here.
Who is this man you've been talking to for 7 years?
Well, to me, he's a convict that was a failure. I mean, he's the person that is not capable. I mean, and I still lay it to the way the book reads. It wasn't to start cleaning the earth or anything. I mean, there was a drug burn that initiated the first one, and the black guy, the first tone of violence that surfaced anyway. And then the death of Gary Hinman, there again, it was dope related, and it just kept feeding from there. And so it had no spiritual aspects at all. It was just a bunch of guys out there, kids out there that was living, doing their own thing. And it used to be party time and play time. And then through drugs and the whole bit, well, it started getting a little bit nasty, a little bit meaner. And first thing you know, there's murders.
In my whole life, I've burglarized a grocery store, stole some nickels and dimes, busted open a stamp machine, stole a few automobiles, and cashed a couple checks. I'm a petty car thief. I've been with prostitutes and bums and winos and all my life. The street is my world. I don't pretend to go uptown and be anything fancy. I can. But I find more real in the world that I'm in than I do the tinsel. And the real world is the one I have to deal with every day, you know. Believe me, if I started murdering people, there'd be none of you left.
Where's the man that I was dealing with in this interview? Is it you?
Do I look like a man to you?
Well, where's the gentleman that I was communicating with in the letters?
A gentleman? I sent you a telegram. My name is Penny Daniels. I'm from Inside Story in Miami. You were dealing
with... This is Miami. They said this was France. Didn't they say this was France?
That's what they said over there, but that information must have been lost, right?
Oh, you were under the impression that this was an interview with someone from France?
Yes.
No, this is Miami. Inside Story, you were dealing with Fran Myers, Justine Schmidt, and then I sent you a telegram. My name is Penny Daniels, and this is Dale West. Why don't you have a seat, Mr. Mitchell?
No, we'll finish. We'll get our what we're doing here. What was the letter that you got? Do I get a roll of this film?
Do you get a roll of this film, a copy of it?
No. No, see?
I'm sorry, I don't understand your question.
See, what I did was I got a deal with this guy from France that he gets a roll of film and I'll do the interview with him and then he gives me a roll of the film on the side. I get to do a half hour with him and then I get a half hour of my own.
To make any statement you want.
Yeah, to send to this address here.
That was not our... I'm not the person from France and we are not the station.
Well,
However, what is the address? Yeah. I might be open to talking about it too.
Yeah, in other words, like, we already made a deal between Miami and me. They said that was okay too.
That could be. I'm not aware of it. What is the address?
The address is in Hollywood.
Hollywood, California?
Yeah.
Who is the person? Nick Bugas?
Yeah.
Who is he?
It's a Frenchman.
You want me to give you a tape of the interview that you do here and send it to this man?
I want a half hour off of your line. In other words, we're doing this for you. Then I want a half hour here for me. Why am I doing this? I have to carry the... I'm not a celebrity. I'm not a person to interview. I don't like to play interviews. But I'm stuck under a game of ignorance. I'm stuck under little brain people, you dig? And I have to try to get around that the only way I can. The only time I can get unhandcuffed is when I'm here with the media. I've been 20 years in handcuffs, if that makes any sense to anybody in this world. You know, 20 years in handcuffs, you know, so he can play daddy. You know, to you, I mean, you know, get off that trip, you know, get up off of me. And I'm serious. I said, get up off of me. You understand what I'm saying now?
I understand what you're saying, and I'd like to talk about some of these things. Yeah. Are you telling me, let's get this straight, are you telling me that you'll do the interview, or you...
Yeah, I'll do the interview for you, and then I get a few minutes to send it to this.
No problem.
No problem. I figured that, you know, that would be worth something, you know.
Okay.
So...
Do you want to sit down?
Do you know that it's going to depend on largely on what you say, Charlie, if we're going to allow it to exit the institution?
What do you mean? You're going to put your importance up over somebody like you're somebody? No, you ain't nothing but a lot, man. Shut up and keep your mouth shut. You don't run anything.
Okay, just let
me
know.
You don't run a damn thing. You don't run a damn thing. You understand what I'm saying to you? You don't run nothing here. You know, whatever he's telling you, you know, if he's putting his importance up over you, there ain't nothing over you right now, except my old lady in Florida. My old lady's over you in Florida. And that's the only thing that's over you. You take that all the way to Regan and his horse.
Who is your old lady in Florida?
Squeaky's in Florida right now.
And
they just took her from Kentucky. She's trying to get us a trial. We didn't get a trial. We didn't get our rights. We didn't get anything. We were tried by the news media. We weren't tried by the courtroom. The courtroom just, the news media was selling it. It was making money. They was buying and selling it. And when it's making money, they're going to sell it. They don't care who's got to pay the price for it. But we had to pay the price for it, you know. I didn't break no law. Everybody in the world knows that. But it seems like these people around here, they can't get it in their brains that I didn't break no law.
What has Squeaky got to do with me?
Because there's only one woman, girl. There's only one woman.
What does that mean?
That's Jesus. You're on the cross, woman. You don't even, you know, you people don't even know where you're at or what you're doing or what's going on in the world.
You're saying there's one woman. Is there one man?
Man died in the wars. Arlington Cemetery's got all the men. 2,000 years, the man's been dying. It's all a reflection of mother.
Yeah.
Unless you go to Lebanon somewhere.
I need to put a mic on you, is that okay?
Unless you go to Lebanon or go to Babascon or go out in the jungle, you might find one, you know. But I don't think you're going to find one not out in this madness. You know, they're all working for you. She knows that, you know. Sure she does. Sure she knows it. She knows there's only one. It's got nothing to do with me personally. When I got out of jail last time, she come up and she said, can I hang around you? I told her, no, no way. She says, why? I said, every time I let you end up in jail, put you back in jail.
This was in 67?
Yeah, this was in 67.
You knew her before then?
I knew her in dreams. Her daddy's a rocket scientist. He makes rockets and Boeing aircraft. And I met her on a street corner. She didn't have no place to stay. Her parents kicked her out, you know. And I knew what her heart was and where she was running and what she was doing, because that's an old garbage can to me. I've run through that before. So I told her, no way. And she said, I won't put you back in jail if you don't break the law. If you break the law, you put yourself back in jail. And that's true, you know. So I said, all right. So I said, you give me your word as your bond, and your bond is your life? And she said, yeah, I give you my word. You know, I said, okay. So she hung around for a while. And the reason
that there was a lot of girls around that place is because I play music. And I play pretty good music.
Do you play music now?
No, these jealous snake that's on top of me are lacking in manhood. So they don't want nobody like me to live. They do their damnedest to kill me every day they get the chance, you know.
You're not allowed a guitar then?
No, I'm not allowed anything.
Do you miss the music?
Yeah, that's what I live for, music, yeah.
How long has it been since you played?
Quite a while. They let me touch it every once in a while, but they don't want me to play. It's like everybody wants the attention. I don't want the attention. I just like to play music.
Why are you doing this interview, Charlie?
Because I can get another roll of film and send it down to Boogus, and I owe him a little something.
Is that the only reason?
And that my old lady's in Miami, that she's in Florida.
What has that got to do with it? What has she
been... Well, she'll see this, and she'll know that I'm still where I'm at in relation to here.
You call Squeaky your old lady. Does that mean you have a romantic relationship
with
her?
No, I don't play all that, you know, she's just a friend, what you would call a friend. She does what she wants. I do what I want. She's just a person. They say that I was a leader in a family of people, which is bull. That's bunk. I had a lot of friends because I play a lot of music. A lot of people like my music. And we were all friends. There was no such thing as follower, leader. There was no leaders or followers. There was just people. Intellect, intelligence. There were people, intelligent life forms. And there was a bunch of kids who were working out their problems for that particular time in that particular space. And each had to do what they felt they had to do for the problems that they were working on, which really had nothing basically to do with me. I'm not of the 60s. I'm not a generation of the 60s. The 60s were little kids to me. The Beatles were like punk rock is to you. That's what the Beatles was to me. That's not my era. My era was Bing Crosby. I'm 53 years old. I'm not a teeny bopper. But all the kids, they would come to me and say, we got no place to go. And I'd say, well, I got no place to go. You know, so they were throwaway kids, and I was a throwaway kid.
Tell me a little bit about your background. Tell me if you could describe your childhood and couple of sentences, how would you describe it?
I didn't have a childhood.
Tell me a little bit more. Tell me more.
I went to a reform school in 43, and I've been fighting ever since.
Was it as bad as you describe in the book that was co-authored by Newell Emmons?
That wasn't my book.
That wasn't your book.
No.
But what about the parts describing your childhood and your experiences in reform school?
That was him writing a book.
The part about that school in Indiana, that's not true, how you were treated?
Bits and parts of it are true and bits and parts of it aren't.
Give me a hint.
He gets little information from other people. And anybody that wants to tell him something, what he wants to believe and what he feels will sell to the public, then that's what they'll write.
Okay, well, let's not talk specifically about that book then. Tell me how you would describe how bad it was for you in these reform schools.
A child don't know what bad is.
Well, he says in the book that you were raped, that you were beaten constantly.
Oh, come on, man.
That's not true.
That's what he would like to believe. But ain't nobody can do that.
So you didn't have a lousy childhood then?
Yeah, I had a terrible childhood. But I'm from here.
In other words, it didn't get to you.
No, I've never sold out. They've never beat me. I haven't been beaten.
Tell me about your terrible childhood.
The child doesn't know what terrible is.
You don't want to talk about it, I tell
you. I'm telling you, a child doesn't know what terrible is.
Give me a little description of it.
What is terrible? You know, terrible. What does that mean, terrible?
I don't know. You used the word, so I'm trying to get you to
describe
it.
No, I didn't. He used the word in his book. I didn't. I'm not a sniveler. I don't cry. I don't snivel. I don't look for excuses to get off on other things. You know, I accept my position and I hold it.
Let me ask you something. How do you spend your days now, since you're not allowed to play music? How do you spend your time in jail?
Sitting.
Just sitting?
Mm-hmm.
Do you do anything else? Do you read?
No.
Do you walk?
No.
At one point, I read somewhere that you were making dolls. Is that true?
I do. I make little dolls, yeah.
Tell me about that.
I just started taking string and making little dolls and bugs and spiders and little. It's a new art form. I created a new art form.
Anything else like that? Any other things that you do in jail?
Yeah, I run an underworld.
You run an underworld in jail? Mm-hmm. Tell me about that.
You don't see it? I fly birds. I look out for wildlife. I'm trying to redeem my trees. I have an organization called ATWA rolling now, trying to redeem life on the planet Earth from the people that destroy it.
Tell me more about that. Who's destroying the Earth and why?
The things that we do as human beings that are accepted and called right 100 years ago have changed. Years ago, we could cut down trees and we could afford an exuberant lifestyle. We can't afford that no more. We're running out of atmosphere. We're running out of water. Our water's becoming so poisoned and so polluted, we're not going to be able to drink it. The trees are being cut down so fast, lumber companies are just... The United States is owned by foreign corporations. Nixon opened it up for foreign trade. And when Nixon opened up for foreign trade, the people of Europe and the common market in Spain and different places, they don't care about the United States forest. And in short, the United States has been sold out by people who really don't care for anything but money. I've had all the money in the world 3 times. I had to give it back to keep the game going.
What game?
The game. It's a game. Money is a game. It's only real to the people who work for it. The people that don't need to work for money, it's a monopoly game. It's a game of paper. It's all on paper. I've got a production company, and I've got a recording company, and I've got a mansion in Beverly Hills, and I've got Rolls Royces and Ferraris. I've got everything money can buy, but it's all on paper. Everything's done through the companies and through the tax loopholes. And the people that live on that level, they don't care about the average honest mule that just goes back and forth to work. They don't care about the children that are in the streets that are thrown out of this upper echelon of existence. And then when all the children fall down into me on my level, I pretty much identify with them because I was a throwaway also. So it goes to the point of, do you really care?
When you said,
and who does care? And if anybody cares, they're considered crazy. I've been 15 years in the nut ward for trying to stop the trees from being cut down, from trying to rearrange a lifestyle of a bunch of people who don't want to change. But they're going to change because the cold wind is blowing. You're going to change or there's going to be no life left on the planet Earth. And then there's a bunch of little people that are always trying to play act some sort of importance up over the truth about what is rolling on the planet Earth now.
Did you get him?
Or she might use for me. Or we might use for another one of the friends. And I say old lady.
Let's get back to that talk about God for a minute. Tell me once again. I don't know if we got that. What you were talking about being God's messenger. Tell me that again.
Life is God. All life, bugs, birds, trees, everything that's alive is God. The sun is God. But we've got God over here on a cross. We've got a dying man over here on a cross, and we're all kneeling down hoping that if we die, there's a better place somewhere else. Well, you got a whole bunch of people hoping that they die creates a hell of a big energy. And I call it a death wish. It's mother's death wish. It's what everybody's going towards dying, like the Vietnam War when they wanted to blow the world up.
And what have you got to do with God once again?
I'm just a messenger of the truth.
God's messenger?
Life's messenger. We use the word God. The God hooks all the other words up. I'm the Pope. I'm 10 times the Pope. I'm 50 times the Pope. But I'm the Pope in the hills and in the mountains. I'm already out of here. This enclosure here, I'm out of here. My body is stuck here, but my thought is already gone.
When you told me you ran an underworld, is that a joke?
No. No, why would it be a joke?
It's not a joke.
No, when your word is good, it's good.
What do you mean by that?
When your word is good, it's good.
What do you mean by that you run an underworld? What do you mean by that?
A little kid came to me a long time ago in McNeil Island, and he said, would you teach me how to speak English? I said, no, I won't teach you how to speak English. You're too stupid. He said, I'm not stupid. I said, come on, let's go play some handball. So I taught him how to play handball, and I taught him how to speak English, and I taught him how to tell the truth. He lives in Peru.
What has that got to do with running an underworld?
All I got to do is tell him anything I want him to know, and he knows I don't lie to him.
Is that what you did with your so-called followers?
No. No. Yes, 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 in a proportion, yeah. Sure, sure. But I didn't break will. I didn't break the will.
Are you saying that they didn't do anything they didn't want to do?
That's it. That's it. In other words, if I'm with you, whatever you do is your business. I tell you, if you drink out of that cup, you're going to get so-and-so, and you say, well, roo-roo-roo, and I say, well, that's up to you, if that's what you want. If you go ahead and do it, I mean, that's you. I don't break your will.
What did your followers do?
I didn't have any followers. I had some friends.
What did your friends do?
They did whatever they had to do.
And what was that?
Whatever that was.
Did any of your friends kill people?
Sure.
Who did they kill?
They killed lots of people.
Did they kill Sharon Tate and the people that night?
I imagine so. If they said they did, they did.
Did you tell them to?
No.
Let's talk about something else for a minute. Do you ever have any contact with your children? You fathered at least three children, right?
I've got a whole lot of children.
Do you have any contact with them?
I got prisons full of children.
Real children.
I'm talking about real ones. They're as real as you can get.
Children that you fathered, you have prisons full of.
Every child of God is a friend of mine.
Charlie, you know what I'm talking about.
I know what you're talking about. You're talking about, do I have any ego children?
Biological.
If you
children.
And I have a child and you take the child off and you raise him to be like you, he's not like me. He's like you.
Are you in contact with any of your biological children?
I'm not in contact
children?
With anyone.
Squeaky Fromm.
I'm in contact with everyone. Mm.
Are you ever in contact with your mother, your biological mother?
I am my mother.
Are you ever in contact with any other members of the so-called Manson family, your friends?
The Manson family was a music group. The music group I had was called the Family Jams. And all the girls sang in the music group. And all the guys played in the music group. It had nothing to do with a cult. It was a music group.
Whatever happened to those people? Are you in contact with them?
Sure, they're all doing fine. We're all doing the same as we was doing before. You can never split us apart because we were never together. We were together in soul, we were together in truth, and every one of them knows I've never lied to them. I've never lied to anyone about them or around them. They've never seen me in a lie.
Do you ever get letters from people?
Yeah.
Tell me about some of the letters you get from people.
I get all kinds of letters from all kinds of people, all kinds of kids, all kinds of people that are lost, people that are needy.
Do you write them back?
Sometimes, occasionally.
What do you tell them?
Hello, hi, how are you?
Do you give them advice?
Advice. It's within.
Do you give them advice?
If that's advice, it's within you.
That's the advice you give. It's within
well,
you.
Whatever advice is, I.
Do you get visits? Do you get visitors?
No.
Never. You're not allowed visitors.
I've got a lot of people standing on me trying to play important, and each one of them takes a little bit, until finally I've got nothing left, and I sit in the cell. And then this dummy wants to come, and he wants to get his little bit. And this guy, he wants his little bit, and everybody's got their little bit. You dig? And then I'm stuck up underneath. I can't do anything because everybody else is living my life. They're representing me. If all the people that were representing me that quack in one direction, if they turned around and bowed in the other direction, I'd have every head bowed. Because they're doing nothing but representing me. Reagan's court was representing me. The court that Reagan, that I was in, was Reagan's court, was his appointee. He was representing me. Everybody's been representing me.
Let me ask you another way. I've heard that you get a lot of letters and a lot of, have in the past gotten a lot of visits from kids, just kids that you don't know. Is that true?
I am kids.
Have you gotten these kinds of visits and letters from kids that you don't know?
Sure.
Why do you think these kids write you?
Because I am those kids.
What is it about you that they...
I am a child. I never grew up. I never lived in your society. I never went to school. I never had a mother and father. I raised myself up.
What do you think it is about you that makes people want to be a part of whatever it is you're a part of?
I'm brand new. Everything I do is always brand new. I'm on the premise of reality. I walk a real road. I'm a real person inside. I'm not a phony. I don't put on no airs. I say what I think. You see what I'm saying?
Aren't you putting on an air now? Aren't you putting on an act for me?
When you look it back, see if it's an air. See if where you get it. And someone sees it and goes by and they say, "Hey, how you doing?" I say, "Pretty good. How you be? Where does it come from? Where does the energy and power come from? Who recharges your battery?" You know what I'm talking about.
Isn't this an act right now?
What isn't an act? What isn't an act?
So you put on act.
Are you an act?
Sure, so are you.
All right, then.
So we're all an act,
well,
right?
Well, what isn't? The only thing that isn't an act is when someone gets killed. And then it isn't an act because people's fear sees it as being real. So the only thing people see as real is fear. So if the people in the underworld are knocking people down in the streets and breaking their jaws, maybe it's the people in the underworld that want you to see that I am very real, and I am on this planet Earth, and I am moving for Atwa, my air, my water, my trees, and my wildlife, in every way I know how, in every way I can.
Does the end justify the means?
End, there is no end. There is no beginning. Not in Atwa. There's only redeeming life upon the planet Earth.
Does that goal justify any means?
I don't justify or not justify. I lay it out there. What people do with it, it's their business. If they decide to run up and kill Sharon Tate, that's on them. Had you let us put on a defense, we could have explained to you why it happened.
Why did it happen?
All right. You take 20 years, 250 district attorneys, 5,000 policemen, everything the news media has got. You put it on one person. Explain it away. How can I explain away all the misconcepts in 2 or 3 minutes or 5, 10 minutes? Give me a trial in a courtroom. Give me my rights in a courtroom. And then I'll explain it. I can't explain it just in a few words or in a letter or in a postcard. It's too vast. It's too big. It's circled the world 3 times.
What are you asking for, a new trial?
I'm new. I haven't got the first one yet.
You're asking for a trial, though.
Just a trial. Just give me my rights. All I want is the same rights that my fathers died for. The same rights that says United States of America. I see Reagan getting up in the United Nations telling the world how human rights are so important and how we should give all the humans rights. And then he turned around and asked him on the darkest side, "What about Charlie?" And said, "Oh, well, he don't deserve no rights." Well, if I don't deserve no rights, then who does deserve rights? I didn't break no law.
Right now you're coming up for parole. You have the right to come up before a parole board. Do you want to get out on parole?
Parole for what? Parole to where? I want my rights. My rights, you give me a parole every other day, it doesn't give me my rights. If I don't have any rights, he doesn't have any rights. He doesn't have any rights, and you don't have any rights.
I think I know what you're saying.
Yeah, in other words, if everybody gets equal rights, you got equal rights to the rights I got. And that's to sit down and keep your mouth shut or get your jaw broke. Is that the rights you want?
Do you want to get out of jail?
Out of jail? I've been out of jail since 67. I got out of prison in 1967.
Would you like to get out of prison?
I'd like to get my guitar and I'd like to see my friends.
What would you do if you got out of prison?
Depends on what level I got on.
What would you do if you got out of prison on parole?
On parole? I don't know whether I would accept a parole. Because if I accept a parole, then I have to accept a whole bunch of little people play act importance with my life. I'm tired of other people running my life.
Are you saying that you don't want to accept guilt?
Guilt? The hell is that? I can do anything I want, woman.
What would you do if you got out of prison?
I'm out of prison. I get out every day. I get out in these guys every day. I get out all over. I'm everywhere. I know you're going to lock everywhere up. I'm everywhere, man. I'm all things. How are you going to lock that up?
How do you feel about blacks?
Blacks are all right.
How do you feel about Jews?
Jews are all right.
How do you feel about women?
Women, okay.
Why do you wear the sign of the American Nazi Party?
That's my Nazi Party. That's me.
What does it mean?
It means I've been locked up in here since 1943. That I'm standing behind the judges in Nuremberg.
I think I need a little more explanation than that.
There's a line that the judge sets on. There's a premise of crime that the Supreme Court sets on, that the government and the crosses set on. I have been behind the judge since 1943. In the infinite consciousness of those black robes, I have been on the dark side of the world you people live in for 43 years, for a little over 43 years. Juvenile halls, Cook County Jail, Chicago, Indianapolis, D.C., Virginia, I did a lot of time in Virginia, all over the country. I've been in and out of jails. I have nothing against no one unless they got something against me. You come up and say hi, I say hi. You say, I like you. I say, well, I like you. You say, well, I don't like you. I say, well, I don't like you. In other words, however you reflect to me is what I'm going to reflect back to you. I don't care what color you are, where you're from, or what you're doing, what race you are. I am me first, and that is Scotch. I'm from Scotland first. That's me. And I look out for that, number one, me. Just like everybody else does.
Charlie, do you resent the fact that you've been in jail practically all your life? And if so, why did you continue to do things that put you in jail?
Mm-hmm. Split the question, ask one at a time. I can't answer two questions.
Do you resent the fact that you've been in jail practically all of your life?
No, I don't know what resent is. That's a waste of mental energy. It's a waste of time.
Do you feel it's wrong?
Right or wrong, I don't judge. That's what they got guys in robes for. They judge.
Well, I guess then I can't really ask the second part of the question.
Well, what's the second part of the question?
Well, the second part of the question is, if you resent it, then why did you keep doing things to get back into jail? Why did you do so many things to get yourself thrown in jail? You seemed to like it when you were out, according to what I read.
Well, because I'm stupid. I really am stupid. I'm smart in some things, but other things I'm dumb in, you know. Probably if you notice, people that tell the truth generally act like they're kind of retarded. Mentally retarded people I can communicate with real good. And these and dumb people, man, we talk like crazy, you know. In other words, I'm all right with those. And kids I'm okay with. But when you get grown up, then there's a lot of problems. I don't get along too good with grown-ups. And they get me in trouble. people get me in trouble because I don't have the mental capacity to adjust to the outside. And when I get out there, I'm like a little kid. I'm like a little baby in a lot of respects, you know. That's why Squeaky has fought so hard to get me out, because she knows I didn't break the law. She knows I was used by a lot of different people doing a lot of different things, and that I didn't break the law.
What would you do if you got out of prison?
What would I do? Probably play some music, get my guitar, and go back out in the desert. I got some trees. I was planting some trees. I did a crazy thing. I planted some fig trees, and I didn't know fig trees take two trees. Did you know that? That there's male and female trees? I didn't know that. I was planting fig trees, and every water hole I'd go would plant one tree. And I figured one fig tree at this water hole would be just right for the water hole. But then I come to the gym, I looked in the book and find out, man, you got to have two fig trees to have fruit. So I got a whole bunch of water holes out there with one fig tree planted. So I wanted to get back out and put the plant the other side of that, put the other trees out. I like working in the dirt. I like farm work. I like growing things. I like growing things. Gardens and things like that. I like earth things. Earth things I like. I'd probably get back down on the ground, walk around. Just walk around, do the things that everybody does. Nothing. Sit around under a tree. Probably do not much. Not much.
How would you support yourself?
Support myself? See, in other words, like, your lifestyle has got you thinking crazy. You know. You support yourself. I got figs over here. I got raisins over there. I got pine nuts over there. I got pockets full of everything you can eat, you know. I got all I can eat, and where I'm laying down is where I'm sleeping. So, I mean, I support myself. How does a deer support itself?
Every time they've let you out of prison before, you've turned to stealing.
Oh, now I'm stealing. You got me in for stealing. I thought I was in here for something else. I didn't know I was in here for stealing. You got me stealing, too? How do you put everything else on me at least three times? What did I steal?
Have you never stolen anything?
Sure, I stole a whole lot when I was a kid and thought that was cool. I thought that was cool when I was a youngster. I live by the code of the outlaw. I give everything I got and take anything I want.
Do you think you've changed?
No, got a little older probably. Changed? I don't know, changed. How does the universe change?
You think people change when they get older?
When they get older? I don't know, get older. See, all those things that you got in your mind, they don't exist to me. Get older, get younger. I was born 1,000.
See, we're born old and young.
Yeah, I was
born. At the same time.
I was born to... Don't be offended. I'm a nasty old man. And I'm mad. But I put my anger in the right direction. The direction of Atwar. For 20 years we've tried to find intelligent life forms in the United States of America, but didn't seem to be any there. It was all bought and paid for. These guys that sell themselves for that paycheck, they don't exist outside that paycheck.
Why are you mad?
I'm mad at people taking my life.
Putting you in prison?
No, taking my life.
What do you mean?
Well, when you're cutting the trees down, you're taking my life. When you're polluting the water, you're taking my life.
Laughing. You do it on command.
Your justice system ain't working too cool. You know, so I imagine that there'll be another one, Phoenix in behind, doing what's right. All we're trying to do is do what's right. But doing what's right in a world full of people that don't know what right is, it's difficult. Because you got so many interpretations and so many different people in different directions. You've got 1,000 Jesuses. You've got 1,000,000 devils, you've got 25,000 Napoleons, you got every kind of insanity going in the world coming. And Atwa. Atwa also means at war, if you put an R on the end of it.
At war with what?
Pollution. pollution. A revolution against pollution.
So you're telling me all these people think that you hate the blacks and you hate the Jews and you kill people and all you're really trying to do is stop pollution?
All the time it's been the same thing. Whatever people put on me is what they're trying to play themselves on their level.
Tell me once again, I didn't quite get it, why the American Nazi Party signed on your forehead.
When those eight people were killed in Uganda, when that plane was skyjacked, and Idi Amin was put in the position to rule Africa, I was in that episode. And that's the only way I could save my head. Because there was a lot of violence, a lot of fear, a lot of bloodshed was going on in those days and times to stop the drought that was coming over there. We seen the world. Don't you remember when the Lord knows when the cold wind blows, it'll turn your head around? Well, we were all in that thought, trying to change the world, you know? And you can't say, well, the Jews are the chosen children of God, and these Germans are no good because their forefathers fought. No. The Germans are no worse than the Jews. And the blacks are no worse than the Mexicans. And the Mexicans are no worse than the Filipinos. And the Filipinos are no worse than the Chinese. So how do you reach a one with that whole circle? How do you reach a one with that whole circle? How do you have peace on this earth? You can't have peace on this earth unless you let Second World War die. You want to keep the Second World War going? You want to keep selling and buying Germans and dead Indians on TV every day? You know, that's got to stop. The Second World War's got to stop. And it's got to stop in the Jews. The Jews won't let the Second World War stop. They keep the Second World War going. They keep it going. They keep it going. They keep perpetuating it because they're making money. As soon as the Second World War was over, they never stopped the brainwash. The brainwash that they were selling the American public was making money. You see what I'm saying? They were making money. They're not going to stop making money. If the combination's there to make money, they're going to keep selling it. They'll sell it all the way till I'm in the cell with a guy named Milman, Jerry Milman. And he's got pictures of Hitler and Japanese and things all. I said, boy, Hitler must have been a hell of a guy. He said, Hitler was terrible. I hate him. I hate him. I said, why do you hate him? He said, I'm a Jew. I said, well, why do you enshrine this guy? Is he your daddy? And he looked up to his mother's fear. And his mother's fear was Hitler. Hitler was like his father figure. He loved Hitler, but he hated Hitler. He needed Hitler to hold him up. Because Hitler was holding his hate up. Because without his hate, he didn't exist. He didn't have no reason to live unless he had some hate. He didn't have any reason to buy and sell unless the money held him up. If you took the money away from him, you took the hate away from him, he'd be gone. So how do you communicate to a whole group of people? You stand up and you take the worst fear symbol there is and say, there, now I've got your fear. Now I've got your fear. And your fear is your power and your power is your control. I'm your king of this whole planet. I'm going to rule this whole world through Atwa. I want my trees put back. I want my water clean. I want my atmosphere cleaned up. What you do beyond that, I don't care what church you go to or what race you are, what color you are, what booby-gobbly-gobbly-gobbly, and all that nickel and dime personal important trash head stuff. I don't care about that. All I care about is my air, my water, my trees, and my wildlife. And you humans, if you don't get in line with that, goodbye. Because I got biology and I got chemistry. And I got things beyond the nuclear mine. I won't blow it up. I checkmated that. I got all the bombs over here in the corner. I said, no, I'm not blowing it up. Now the next step of dealing with you suicidal maniacs that won't get up off my life, my air, my water, my trees, my wildlife, my fish. You see, I live on the earth. God gave me a life on that earth. And I live there. And everybody that's taken my life off the earth is taking yours off the earth also. It's taking because you don't have any more right than I do. I don't care whether you're black, whether you're green. If I don't have any rights, then you don't have any rights. And what you do to me will be done to you.
Charlie,
mm-hmm.
People have said that you have powers, that you can make people do what you want them to do.
Well, sure. Sure.
That's true?
Why, certainly.
How so?
By making them do what I want them to do.
How do you do it?
Well, these two guys here with that stick. He has power with that stick to make me do what he tells me to do.
So what's your stick?
What's your stick?
I've been under that stick 43 years.
How do you make people do what you want them
to? I just turn that around and give it back to you. What you put on me with that, I just take that and throw it back at you.
Are you saying that you used violence to make people do what you wanted them to do?
No, I don't deal in violence. I'm not a violent person. My record's been, I've been on record, all my life's been on record, and I'm not violent. I learned that whatever you put out, you get back. And I don't like to be hurt, so I'm not going to hurt anyone.
All this stuff about Charles Manson, the guru, the person that people follow, is that true?
Sure.
Why? Why did they follow
because
you?
Because I'm in the soul. I'm in the fist.
What does that mean?
The fist, the family of the infinite soul. The eyes are the windows of the soul. When I show you something once, you know it's there. You've seen it. It's in your soul. It becomes a part of you.
Do you still have people who write to you, who visit you if they can, who follow you?
The whole world's following me. There's no place else they can go.
What do you tell?
I haven't found no place to run. And I'm following the next guy in front of me. Everybody's following someone.
Do you believe that you have powers to...
No more than any other man. Oh, well, all men have powers. Some people know it, some people don't. Some people understand the power they have, and other people don't understand the power they have.
What is it about you that made all these young people come to you, that made them follow you?
The music.
Just the music.
I sing like that. Yeah. Kind of puts you on center, huh?
Well, it's loud.
Yeah, I sing loud. I sing real loud.
It grabs your attention.
It does. It does. It kind of reaches in there and breaks all the pattern in your brain. See, your music is Barry Manilow and all them ooh, pop, pop, and they sing it to little girls for a dollar and a quarter. I'm singing up for God rolls. I'm singing up in the top echelons of the music.
Have you always sung like that?
No. I started a rebirth movement in 67. Everybody else stole it. Carter stole it. Everybody said, oh, this is us. They locked me up and said, oh, this is us. We represent that. You know, I'm important on that. And then they'll want to make their little decision. Then they'll say, let me get in there. Because everybody wants in there first. You know how that goes.
Do you ever think about Sharon Tate and the people that were killed that night?
No, not that much. But everybody said, oh, this is us. They locked me up and said, oh, this is us. We represent that. You know, I'm important on that. And then they'll want to make their little decision. Then they'll say, let me get in there. Because everybody wants in there first. You know how that goes.
Do you ever think about Sharon Tate and the people that were killed that night?
No, not that much. Why should I? A lot of people get killed. People get killed all over the world every day.
Do you feel any responsibility for what happened that night?
None.
You feel no remorse for what happened that night?
How am I going to feel remorse? What am I supposed to feel remorse about? Everyone says, you feel no remorse. I said, can't you understand I'm not guilty of anything? And they say, well, you're supposed to feel remorse. I'm supposed to feel remorse because you don't understand, because you're twisted in your brain. You know, in other words, someone comes in and says, you were in New York City last night. You say, no, I wasn't. And they say, well, don't you feel bad about it? You say, feel bad about what? Say that people that happened in New York City. Man, I wasn't in New York City. I wasn't there. I was in San Diego in bed with some broad I'd met in Big Sur. I didn't have no family. I had a motorcycle, a sleeping bag, and a guitar. Guy, I just got out of the penitentiary. I hadn't been out of jail long enough they say, well, you got our kids to do this, knock you out. You had your kids to do that. Your kids were doing that before I got out of the penitentiary. I just got out of jail. Can't you understand that? You know, you tell the people something and they've got their minds made up a certain way. You dig what I'm saying? And you tell them something and they just don't know. What am I supposed to feel remorse about? Do you feel remorse that every day of my life you've tormented me with these idiots that you got holding me down? That you beat me and knocked my jaw out, you forced me medication, you've drugged me up down hallways, you set my head on every chopping block in the state of California, you've poisoned me, you've done everything, I've puke blood for months and days, man. You've done everything you could do to get me killed, and then you turn around and ask me, do I have any remorse? If I have the right to do to you what you've been doing to me, then that gives me the right to do anything I want to, anyone I want to do it to. Can you see now? Well, you better give me my rights, because as you're doing this to me, you're doing this to all these children, and they're all these cells, and they're growing up just like you're raising them up with no rights. And even the guys in the uniforms are looking at it and saying, what am I doing this for? Why am I cheating this guy? He's got no money. Why don't I go up the hill and take the money away? You know, if you give DuPont the same right you give me, you can put DuPont in the cell and take everything he's got. Take his children, rape his women, drag him up and down the highway. Everything's okay when it comes to doing it to Charlie. And Charlie's been carrying it. And Charlie knows in the background that when the wave comes in, the wave goes out. And each time the wave comes in, the wave goes out. And you're all going to get the reflection in the mirror that you put in this child here. And it's got nothing to do with me helping you, because I'm gone from you people, man. I'm out in the desert. I'm doing what I'm doing. The only people I would be helping, I'll help Squeaky. And I put my life up to protect her, even though I know she's the devil. I'd help Blue. I'd help Green. And I'd help Yellow, and I would help all the girls that got busted with me, because they know me in the thought of this. All of the guys in my father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not true, I would not have told you so. And it's just as true then as it is true now, as it will be true forever and ever and ever. I don't care what the Christians say. Jesus Christ is a reality.
So you feel loyalty to certain people who you feel have stood by you.
Sure, the people that tell me the truth, I'm bound to tell them the truth back. The people that have treated me right, I am bound to treat them right back. The people that have not treated me right, the Holy Ghost will deal with that.
Why do you say Squeaky Fromm is the devil?
Because all women are. They have to be to survive.
Men aren't.
Sure, men are too. Sure, we have both. We hold both balances.
Women are worse?
I would say, yeah. I would say, well, if you get Mama Lion is very vicious. The Queen of England has never lost a war. Woman has the power. Woman sends these guys to work every day. Woman puts it on the road. She has the will. Plus the supermarket. I have the reality of numbers, and I have the fishing pole. I have other things, but see, the games that you guys play with your woman and man thing, we don't play that man-woman thing, you know. You guys are all hung up in them soap operas, they're killing themselves over crazy things that really, you know, it doesn't mean anything. When you peak the peak and you touch the ultimate, then you walk with the ultimate in your soul forever, man. You know, and you can't put a personality on that. You can't say, well, I'll now pronounce you man and wife, you know, and all that thing that was somewhere else, because the rebirth movement that I started, don't go back and pick up the same old shit. Excuse my French. You don't go back and pick up the same old trash can. You start all over. And starting all over means starting all over. And when you start all over, it's a constant rebirth thing. And it's not going back to Sunday school or with Swagger or Baker or the Pope or the rope soap. That's all dead. That's all old game. That's all graveyard game. You know that Jesus was a reality. He died so I could live. I'm not going to miss out on that. I'm getting up on that train too. That doesn't mean that I live by a bunch of foolish rules, that a bunch of old people are left by old people that left by old people that... Because let me run something to you. What it took Jesus Christ 2,000 years to do in thought, in word, in deed, you can do now with television in 2 or 3 months. You see what I'm saying? And what the Constitution and the people that founded this country in 1776 did, you know, like the government's got 9 Supreme Court justices for 20 million people in the 1800s. Man, you got 250 million people. That's like a fat woman, 500 pounds, trying to get into a size 10 dress. The government's not working. The system is not working. And they won't admit it. They think building more prisons is the solution. Building more prisons just add more confusion to the problem that's already at hand. You know?
Charlie, what would you do if you wanted to... Is there anything at all that you would change about your life?
Yeah, I would have planted them other trees. You know, I'm just as stupid as anybody else. I'm no smarter than anybody. I'm no better than anybody. But nobody's better than me either. You know, you could ask that question to yourself, I guess, you know. I don't have any regrets. I don't, you know, it's foolish to regret and think about something that, it doesn't change. Nothing, you know, you can't change anything anyway. I mean, how are you going to change yesterday? Yesterday's gone. You let it go, man. You don't hang on to it and drag it down the road in a sack, you know. I mean, that's part of changing the lifestyle.
What about Helter Skelter?
That's the district attorney's illusion. That's his trick. That's a reflection of his fear, his sex paranoia, all the games that... But he won that reality for you guys. When he said, I versus the people versus the people that he represented, he won Helter Skelter as a reality for those people. But that's got nothing to do with me. Helter Skelter was a nightclub in the desert. That's where I run a poker game and I shoot dice. And I make money and I ride around in dune buggies. It's funny, they say, you're going to the desert. I said, I was going to the desert? I said, LA's in the middle of the desert. What's wrong with you, dummy? He said, you were going to the desert. How can I be going to where I'm in a conspiracy to go to where I'm standing? You know, it doesn't make any sense, man. I mean, it makes sense to you people. Helter Skelter is just simple, just confusion. That's been happening. Let me run something to you. You go to jail, the music's going, da ba da. Da da da, you go to jail. It stops. And you're in jail 10 or 15 years, you get back out and the music's going da 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 da, and you go to jail again. And everything stops. And you get back out. You go to jail again, you come back out and go, and you say, wow, people are going crazy out there, man. Your minds, I don't know how your brains can keep up with all that, you know. Gee whiz, man, you know? So it's the same thing with your dancing and your walking back and forwards and your living of your every ordinary life. And I see why your children are all committing suicide and going crazy, man, because, gee, how you, you know, because you're running in a crazy world. You got a crazy life going on out there, you know? So you ask me if I want to get back out in that? I haven't been able to get to the penitentiary yet. I've been 18 years trying to get to jail. I was in the penitentiary, and I got out, and I come back, and I haven't been able to find the penitentiary yet. You know, the penitentiary seems to have gone. They moved it somewhere. And this is another thing. Isn't it funny that while you would get Amnesty International to take millions of dollars from the United States to help prisoners out of jail in other countries, when you got political prisoners right here in the United States that you're overlooking, that you won't accept, you got people all over this country that are in here for political reasons.
What year were you born?
34.
9 years old?
Yeah.
What was the first bus for?
The first place?
The first bus.
My mother got out of jail. My mother got out of the joint and put me in with the monks, in with the Catholic monks, the brother monks, there in Terre Haute, Indiana.
Yeah? They treat you bad?
No, they treated me like they treat all the other kids. But I seen them as a bunch of old women. So I ran off from there, I escaped out of the hood. Got out of that hood and went on. Went to Chicago.
Like you weren't raised up.
Please. No, I wasn't. I raised
myself
up.
You were like the wolf boy.
That's right. I raised myself up. Sure. Sure. I got a different way of doing everything. I got my own way, you know. Does that make me bad?
Makes you violent and bad, yeah.
I'm only as violent as I have to be. If I don't have to be violent, I'm not. But I was raised up to where if you didn't fight, you got If you didn't fight, you got taken away and your stuff was taken away. And I got 40 years of fighting in here. I can't read and write, but I can fight.
If I was guilty of something, and after all the pressure they put on me, and they put that medication on me and all the doctors and drug me up down the hallways and done everything they could do to kill me, I've had this whole country down on me trying to murder me for all kinds of different, everything they don't understand, what they don't know, what they can't realize, every little insecurity they got, here they come bringing it to me. Digging, I got to carry it on my back. Do you think I would still be here if I was guilty of anything? And look me in the eye. Look me straight away in the eye. Do I look like I'm guilty about anything?
You look more guilty than anyone I ever looked in the eye in my life.
Really? Yeah, you see what I'm saying? In other words, the guys you're trying to make me into is impossible. What you're doing is you're creating a legend, you're creating a beast, you're creating whatever you are judging yourselves with into the word Manson. And that's not me at all.
You're not a beast, Charlie. You are a beast.
See? I'm whatever you need me to be for you. And whatever you make me is what you'll carry the rest of your life and forever.
You named yourself, Charlie. That's
right. No. You don't even know what that means. I'm the man in the mirror, guy.
I know, man.
You know, if you like me, I like you. If you don't like me, I don't like you. You swing at me, I'll swing back. You dig? You cut at me, I'll cut you. You know, whatever you point to me, I'll get back to
you. But it's more than that, though, isn't it, Charlie?
Well, sure, I'm in harmony with God. That's just a word. We don't, you know, we use the word God.
Or the devil.
Oh, the devil, yeah. You could use the word devil or demons or whatever you want to call it.
Mostly the devil in your world, eh, Charlie?
Okay, I'll play. There's no game I can't play.
The people that say
I haven't played.
You are the devil here.
Okay, I'll be the devil then.
You like that?
Don't like or dislike nothing. I see everything as it is. Your courtrooms have convicted me for being Jesus Christ in one courtroom.
Well,
and then in the other courtroom, you convicted me for being a devil. Now, if you believe in your own courtrooms, you've convicted me for being the father of this country. We'll say that I am all these things that you think I am.
Right.
Wouldn't that be more fearful than letting me try to be a nice guy? Would you want to make me into those things? Would you want me to be, do you need someone like that in your world? That's your judgment now. The judgment you're making on this mirror, man, you got to carry. You want to make me a terrible, violent, no good, so-and-so, and roo-roo-run? When actually, in reality, I'm a deadhead, man. I've been dead since 1951.
So what'd they do?
They did whatever they did. That's a dispensation of the Pope. It's the same thing he does with the cardinals, man. It's the same thing they do with the committee.
Did you tell those women to kill somebody?
Melcher,
someone who reneged on a drug debt.
Hey, let me tell you something about
a woman. Tell me something.
The women I don't got to tell them what to do. If I got to tell them what to do, I'll set them up on the highway and get them away from me. I don't deal with women I got to tell them what to do. They know what to do. If they don't know what to do, they better stay away from me.
And in your case, they knew to kill.
They knew to take care of me.
They knew to kill
for you. They knew to look out for number one.
They knew to kill for you.
No.
Susan Atkin come home to you, bloody hands.
Yeah.
She says, Charlie, look what I did for you.
Yeah. I give you the world. I just killed myself and I give you the world.
So? How'd you react?
I say, you dumb I already had the world. You just put me back in jail again. That's what she did. She put me right back in jail.
When you and Mel write a book, what are you going to talk about? What are you going to try to bring out in your book?
I never even thought of anything like that. I'd have to give that some thought. I was doing this on Mel's request.
Mm-hmm.
He wanted to write the book. I don't particularly care to explain nothing to you. I don't look up at you for any reason to bring my report card home anymore. Does that make sense?
Well, no. What I'm trying to find out is, what would you like to bring out in the book that can teach other people?
What can you teach other people?
That's what I'd like to know. What do you think you can teach other people?
That's what I'd like to know, too. I know how to be reborn and start all over. I start all over. I don't start all over with the same old. I just start all over. Even though I might be old, I'm still brand new every day because I do one day at a time, just like that old convict used to tell me. Isn't that what he used to say, Mel? One day at a time. So I've learned to live my life in one day at a time.
Is there anything you think you can pass on that society really is missing and that you can tell them about?
Society knows when it wants to know that it's just a jellyfish and is only controlled by the people who want to move the sheep around. They'll tell them anything. Everybody knows that everybody's lying. Do you know anyone that tells the truth? Can you trust a lawyer? Can't trust a lawyer. You can't trust, who can you trust? The president, Nixon, Watergate? Look at where your children are looking at it from. Who can they trust?
So you would try to tell parents something about raising children?
I would try to tell the children how to help the parents.
How?
By realizing that the parent is the child. Because he doesn't understand the child, but the child understands the parent. I've talked with little kids, they just tell the truth. No lie in them.
What do you want to point out in the book, if you bring that out? What would you like to point out?
You people are on your road going where you're going.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't want to stop from going where you're going, I'm not going to stop you. You know, you're going to your destruction, not mine. I've already established mine. You know, I've already went through mine. I've been judged. The judge gave me 9 life sentences.
But hold a minute. You really are. But in your philosophical talk, a lot of people won't, it'll go right over their heads. That's what I'm trying to say. Put it so they can understand it in lay language. Can we do that?
Well, it's sad all over, really. You know, it's hard for me to express how much sadness that I've went through to reach this point of understanding that I'm now talking to you from. How are you going to help somebody that don't want help?
Will
hit them in the head and make them do it?
Will your book do that? Will you try?
Will I try?
To explain that.
Will I try to help you people destroy me some more? Is that what you're saying?
No.
That's what I'm doing here.
Will your book help children? Help parents?
I don't know whether it would help anyone. I've never thought about that. You guys would have to show me what help is so I'd know what it is. You teach me, I'll learn. I'm just a little kid in mine. See, I've been in jail 30-some years. I never lived in your world outside. I'm like a little kid out there.
Will your life story help somebody else to understand how to proceed?
If it was possible to present everything that's came down in the last few years in the proper perspective, it would be advantageous to other people, I would imagine. But if they had eyes in their head and they could see under the bed, they'd see that heads of lead and eyes of wood. It doesn't really matter because rubber fingers is taking the hand off into the universe anyway. The level of comprehension that you hold in your mind is only taught to you by a school book that's in a sorority house. My father jumps off the Second World War in the ruptured ducts that were in the little pins and the buttons in Section 8 in the nut wards. And all the people that have gone crazy.
Your father was crazy?
My father was all men that I've ever met in prison. Mel's one of my fathers. Creepy Carpus is another. I learned something from everyone. The captains, the wardens. I never missed anybody. I learned as much as I could from everybody I could get a hold of. And I've never met anybody that I couldn't learn something from. But now that I have learned what I've learned, I don't think you people want to know what I know. You wouldn't like it.
Why?
Well, because it's not very nice.
Well, why?
because the people that you let run your lives aren't very nice. The people that govern you, the people that tell you people what to do, they're not good people.
Let me change the subject for a minute. You've been back on a job out of segregation for how long now?
I don't know. I got up and came out here today.
How long have you been working in the chapel?
I explained to you, I live one day at a time.
Right.
I don't have any other life outside one day at a time.
What brought you back into the mainline population?
What brought me back into the mainline? The preacher. Mm-hmm. With his love and respect and help. He got me back on the mainline.
Mm-hmm. After all that years of solitary, all those years of solitary and segregation, how is it?
Still right now, I'm doing the same day I've always done. I've just had to bring it a long ways. But it's still today, and it's still a good day. And every day it gets a little better, no matter what you do to me.
Are you at peace with yourself?
Whatever that means, I never even thought about to ask myself if I was. I don't generally talk to myself. But I guess talking to yourself would be all right.
He said to me, you know,
you want a sound check from us?
I'm all set.
I want to ask you a question.
Sure.
I want you to give this question a lot of consideration. You don't have to answer me now, but can you imagine what it would be like to be interrogated by the SS?
I don't know whether I could imagine it or not.
Think about it.
Well, I know what their tactics are.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Can I answer it after the interview?
There's no doubt about it, is there?
Can I answer it after the interview?
Very serious, isn't it?
Sure it is. Can I answer you after the interview?
No, you don't have to answer me. You can just think about it.
I will.
In your everyday doings?
Let's talk about Helter Skelter.
Mm-hmm.
Bugliosi, Payne Shue, as a small would-be pop singer, as he describes it, of little talent. How do you react to that?
Bugliosi looks in the mirror every morning when he shaves, and that's the only person in Bugliosi's world, just him. Ask his wife. She knows it.
What about the accuracy of the book, though, Charlie?
He had the dates right and the names right, but he had a million illusions that had nothing to do with my reality. He was only trying and convicting his own reality. Didn't have anything to do with me. I've already been through all these prisons.
But he did paint you as probably one of the most universally known persons.
To who?
Around. To who? Readers. People who read it.
And they believed it?
I don't know. What do you think?
Then they're not as good as what they read, are they?
But the book, how accurate or inaccurate is it?
I never read it.
Didn't you brief it one time?
I read parts of it.
Yeah. How did you find it?
Like I say, it was reflections of what he was thinking. It had nothing to do with me. Seriously, the Charlie Manson that you created, that's not me. That's only an illusion in your minds. It hasn't got anything to do with me.
What's the real Charlie Manson?
I haven't really been able to make him up. See, I've just been reborn again, see, and I'm learning now. I'm starting all over, and I'm learning. The preacher's teaching me, the teacher's teaching me. The counselor's counseling me, and the doctor's looking out after me. The guards don't bother me that much, and I don't bother them that much. They do their jobs and raise their kids, and I do my job and do what I do for my kids.
You know, there was a time a while back where when you got out into the main line, you ran into trouble. I remember Bobby Davis up at Folsom.
I ran into trouble?
Well, you got into trouble.
Who told you that? You see what I'm saying?
Did it happen? Did you fight?
Many things have happened. No, I didn't fight.
Were you fought? Were somebody come after you?
Were I fought? Sure, I've been fought many times.
Did somebody come after you?
Someone come after me? No, someone could come after me if they wanted to.
But did they?
No, they've always left me here. Nobody wanted me.
You haven't had any trouble on the outside?
On the outside
past.
Where?
In prison.
In the prison, no. On the population, no, I get along with most of the convicts. The convicts that get along with themselves. There's much harmony in prison. More every day. There's much wisdom in the prison. More every day.
Getting back to the book, what is this magnetism that people keep referring to? And it's been beyond that. People writing you, wanting to meet you. Your people that you had in the desert.
Mm-hmm.
What is the magnetism?
Why don't you answer that question?
I'm asking that question.
Well, can't you see?
Well, tell me, what is it?
Well, what do you think it is?
Do you know?
Do you know?
Don't play games with me.
It's no
Seriously.
Game. I know. That's why. That's why you're asking me questions, and I'm not asking you questions.
Okay.
You see, I don't need to ask you questions. I already know.
Could you tell me?
Sure, I can tell you. Do you have the time?
I'm here.
Where would you like to start?
Well, what is it? Go ahead and tell me.
What is what? Are you secure?
Charlie.
The government is the United States. The government has never been more secure. Never been more secure than it is right now.
Hold it, bud. Seriously, I want to know. All right.
Okay.
What is it that draws people to you?
Music, motion, generating, attention, reality. I know. When you know, you just simply know. Jesus on that cross, you know he's there. Is he there? Is the cross there? I know the cross is there. You don't have to put me on the cross to witness for the cross. I can see the cross. Now what I'm trying to do is get back to earth so I can go out in the desert. I've already cleaned that thought up once. And you put another president in.
But you said it
was people.
And every
time I clean it up, you put another president in.
All right. You said it's people who are in harmony with you. What do you mean by that?
The people that are in harmony with themselves, in the will of a child. The child has a will. You tell the child to come here and the child will walk over. You tell him to sit down and he'll sit down. He's just in the will of the child. God and his children are in the will of a child. It's just as simple as the Bible said that you must be as little children before you enter the kingdom of heaven. If the Christians had believed in the Bible, then we wouldn't have all this conflict. But evidently, the only ones that are in conflict now are the Christians.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like they don't seem to believe in their own God for some reason. I don't know what it is. Maybe they need to see him on the cross again. Or maybe they should pray for him to come out of the sky in a silver platter. Or, you know, I don't know. I'm just here, and you're there. And who is your reality? And where do you get your energy from? And where does your soul flow? And your thoughts? And how do you know? Unless you have to come and say, Charlie, how's the Dow Jones?
You read the Wall Street Journal?
Certainly I read the Wall Street Journal. I'm right at the top of your brain. And I'll read the Wall Street Journal until you let me walk out that door a free man. Or we'll just use Indian head pennies for earrings.
What if you did get a parole date in November? What would you do?
Then I would give it some serious thought. I don't have room in my mind for could-bes. I have to deal in what is. I can't think about what I want. I have to deal with what I'm allowed to have.
What if you got a date?
If I got a date, then I would probably have a date.
Do you know what you'd want to do?
Yes, I have many plans. A lot of plans. I'd like to clean up the water. I'd like to go up in the mountains and start at the top of the mountains and clean the springs up. Take all the pollution out of the water so I could drink it. Clean up all the green things and pick up all the old beer cans and clean all the way to the ocean. And then maybe we might be able to save a little air and water for our children. Because I'm living in my child's world now. I'm working on his world. My world already went to the gas chamber.
What if you don't get a date?
If I don't get a date, then I won't have a date.
Have you thought about it, then? I know you want to get a date. What if you don't?
I've gave it some thought, but not that much. I've gave it thought in relation that it's possible that they'll be pushed to make some sort of move to alleviate the pressure that they've created on themselves. If there's any way that I could help that, I would, then that way I could achieve what I'm after also. All I want is what the Constitution said I could have, the liberty and the right to look for my freedom the way I want. If you gave the Constitution to me like you said you were supposed to, then I wouldn't be here, and I wouldn't have been here the last 11 years. But if you let your politicians play like they're Christians and use your courtroom to further their own purposes, then all you're doing is big business with your own children's lives. And it really doesn't make sense to me, but I don't have the president's spot to make any change. If I had the control to make the change, I have the power to.
Come on and go off?
Nope. Oh, yeah, I see it. So if I can get comfortable here, I might be able to sit all the way down.
You know, we were talking about this. The book Helter Skelter.
Right.
You said that there are a lot of things wrong with it. What's wrong with it?
Well, book's all right. Got good paper and all in it. All this paper comes from trees. It's a shame to waste all your trees writing this trash for your children to be raised up in. Do you want your children to live according to the gospel of Helter Skelter?
Where are the inaccuracies in it?
Well, it would take me as long as it took him to point them out. It took him 2 years in court to invent them. It would take me 2 years in court to uninvent them and redo them and show their proper perspective of it.
Bugliosi.
Yeah. Helter Skelter simply means confusion. And if you don't see the confusion in the world, that's always been confusion in the world, then I guess you don't know what confusion means. But like, I get out of jail, and every time I get out of jail, society's moving a little faster, and they're doing crazier things. And I get out and I can never adjust to it outside because it's almost impossible to do anything right. Everything is wrong to somebody. I mean, you can't, you have to hide, and you know, day people and night people and everybody all divided up. And
did they make up the evidence introduced in court?
A big percentage of it they found and created themselves. They'd pushed a fingerprint together till it got to be, they justified it, and then they'd send it to another office and let them push it a little bit. Then another office, and they'd push it, and then finally they'd find another point till they finally come up with a fingerprint.
Mm.
Then the people that supposedly left the fingerprint has never lied to me, nor I to them. told me, and I wasn't even there in that particular portion of the crime. I was over in this particular portion of it. In other words, all the little things that they come up with, like the trailer, the door from the trailer that's supposed to have had what we wrote on it, is what they wrote on it, and then they burnt the ranch down to cover that up, you know?
But in no way, are you saying, in no way are you connected with either the Tate or LaBianca killings?
No, I'm not saying anything like that. I'm saying that if it would have come out in the courtroom, I would have explained what happened. All we wanted to do to start with was tell the truth, but the lawyers wouldn't let us because they wanted to sell it. We just wanted to tell the truth, but they didn't want the truth to come out because they couldn't write books with the truth, couldn't make big money, couldn't sell all this madness. All the fear and the vicarious thrill for somebody.
Charlie, regardless of Helter Skelter, do you belong behind bars?
There's no behind bars.
Do you belong in prison?
There's no prison. It's only in your mind.
Do you belong in an incarcerated position?
There's no such thing. There's only you denying my will. Whoever denies my will keeps me locked up here. If everybody agrees to let me go, then I'll walk out, and then I'll be free. And my chains are in everybody's mind. It's in their will. If you will me to be locked up, then I must stay locked up. If you will me to be free, then I'll be free. It's not as complicated to me as it is to you. You look at it through the books and the paperwork. I don't look at it that way. I look at it from the way I look at it. So I'll ask you the same questions. Do you think you deserve to be locked up somewhere?
I'm asking the questions in the interview. Can I do it?
Well, certainly, but you have to ask yourself the same time.
I realize that.
You know, if justice came, where would we all be? We'd all be in some sort of trouble, wouldn't we? That's why we have Jesus. See, he takes up the slack.
Let me get back to the book for a minute. What do you think Mel is going to try to bring out on your life?
The years that we've known each other through the prisons, and the point of view that he has from the other side about someone that's went through a dilemma that he understands, because he's been in many dilemmas of the same nature, maybe not as vast, but then I think that he wants everyone to know that I'm not really the guy that you think I am, but the guy that you made me.
How did we make you?
Well, you raised me from childhood.
How, in what respect are you?
Well, when you have a child that nobody wants, he's always sent to boys' school, orphanage, reform school, or someplace like that. And then they keep him till he gets to be an old man.
Were you beaten as a child?
That hasn't really got anything to do with anything.
Were you abused as a child?
Well, we're all abused now and then. That's not really an issue to anything.
What is the issue?
Not to your question.
All right, what is the gut issue?
In the book that he wants to do.
What is the gut issue?
Well, I think he just wants to put what he thinks is wrong right and give another point of view. And really, what I really think is, I think Mel's done just about everything he wants to do, and he don't have anything else to do. I think he just wants to do it just to be doing it, because it gives him something to do.
Hold it, bud.
Well, it would make sense. It's just another game to play, see?
He would
give him immunity for burglaries or let him off some deals. If they stole a few cars, he wouldn't prosecute them if they told him something. And they'd lay in their cells just working, trying to think up something, anything they could think of to get up off that conviction where they wouldn't have to go to the penitentiary. Told him a lot of things, and most of the people I didn't even know. Linda Kasabian, for example, she'd only been at the ranch a couple weeks. I'd seen her maybe twice. You know, like, I never paid that much attention to the people that came and went at that ranch. They just came and went as they chose.
So you're saying he's took a few pieces of truth?
And messed it with his ability to play with words and colleges and books and things, and he wanted to impress someone with all the things he's learned, and he wanted some attention, and he wanted to be all the things in the movies, you know, so he played his part. And I wasn't allowed to play my part. I was only allowed to sit down and be the figure that was dragged off into the hole all the time. Because he had the money behind him, because he said he had the people behind him. But that's another thing that's wrong with your court system. Your court system's not based on the will of the people, it's based on the will of the money. So your courts are not really protecting anything but the money. It doesn't have much concern for the people anymore.
I've got a curiosity. Can I ask you a question?
Mm-hmm.
Remember you had an X years ago and you changed it now to a swastika?
No, I never changed. It's been the same thing all the way along.
Wasn't it always an X?
No, it never was.
What's it stand for?
It stands for whatever I mean it to stand for, and whatever I make it stand for, and whatever I want it to stand for.
But you didn't one time say you were X-ing yourself out?
No, that was your newspapers that gave you that.
What does it stand for you?
It stands for many things. It would take 2 or 3 weeks to explain all the things that I've built.
Can you give me an example?
In the image, certainly I can give you an example. Of the United States flag of America.
The swastika?
The rising sun in the German and the Japanese flag, the Star of David to the Israelis, the whatever country or nation or people or cause has always had a symbol.
And that's your symbol?
That's mine. I put that there from 2 or 3 other symbols. I didn't want to put a Christian symbol, and I didn't want to put an Antichrist symbol, and I didn't want to put a pro-communism, and I didn't want to put an anti-thermoflakaflaflaflaflaflaflops and all that kind of stuff that you play.
But it is a swastika. That would be Germany, wouldn't it?
No, that's not a Nazi. Hitler got that sign from mysticism and reversed it. He did the same thing, only he did it backwards. You know, it's the thought still here, just like the thought that he picked up was there when he picked it up. The thought has always been here. Since the pyramids have been here, since David and the giant, since the whole thing, it's always been here. And every once in a while, there's a guy like Gandhi that comes and picks it up. Or there's a guy like Maharaja Yogananda, or somebody coming out of some prison, or somebody doing something, and they pick it up for a while, and they carry it for a few steps. And then when they're gone, you say, oh, what a good guy he was. But while he's here, he's always just no good at all, you know.